everybody. This is Lisa, aka Wolf and Storm, coming at you live with another review for Doctor Who. I know I said I'd be back before to review the New Year's Day special and Around the World in 80 Days and the latest box set for Christopher Eccleston's Ninth Doctor Adventures. I know. And I haven't been around. Needless to say, things happened, and between work and dealing with the kids and some other things, I just didn't have the energy to do it. I suppose this is not to say that my love of Doctor Who has gone downhill. It's just that after the New Year's Eve special, I was like, I just felt kind of drained. And I really didn't like what I was seeing. Not that I like what I'm seeing now either. It's not any better. We just got, this past Easter on the 17th, the Easter special, Legend of the Sea Devils. And I almost didn't want to do a review for this because I was like, is it really worth it? But there was some stuff that went on in that episode that I really feel I need to address. Really, really, really feel I need to address. But before I go any further, everybody knows that the New Year's Day special was shit. It was hackneyed. It was ridiculous. Most of the plot made no sense. The Daleks looked like a bunch of idiots because they couldn't get through just a regular metal door. I mean, like, come on. It seemed like most of it was Thasmin setup, which is, again, ridiculous because they don't have a relationship. I don't know why people think they do. This was mostly based off of fan desire to see them on Twitter, and one day the people at BBC just happened to cotton on to this fact and were like, oh look, the fans like Thasmin, let's do Thasmin. Not because they had taken painstaking steps to evolve an actual organic relationship between these two characters, but, well, the fans like it, so, I mean, we want the fans to think we're cool, so, and that we're inclusive, you know, that we, diversity, right? So let's get it done, even though there's no development whatsoever. So, yeah. It seems like this era of Doctor Who is just kind of boiling down to the Thasmin show. Yeah. I know that probably sounds weird coming from me, card-carrying, card-toting, 9th and 10th Doctor Rose shipper. But even I was cognizant of the fact that back then, during the Russell T. Davies era, that the show did not revolve around just them. There was so much other overarching plot and so many other stories and characters that were going on. I didn't need to have my every waking moment, every episode filled up with Dr. Rose shippiness. I enjoyed the episodes, whether or not there was Doctor and Rose stuff in it. The Doctor and Rose stuff was the bonus. But the main draw was just the episodes themselves. Anyway. So before I go any further, please don't forget a like, subscribe, share, hit that button, smash that bell, so you can get updates on further videos. Surely to God, because we only have one episode left in this era, thank Jesus, the centenary special in September. We know for a fact that before that, in the coming weeks, we will be getting more information about the casting decision for the 14th Doctor, and I for sure will have a video on that. Everybody in Doctor Who verse will have a video on that, because it's the one piece of information that we've been waiting for, and it's also kind of the one piece of info that could make or break, you know, where the show goes, other than the whole timeless child thing that really needs to be addressed. So please go ahead, like, share, subscribe, smash that button, hit that bell, so I can keep on keeping on doing what I'm doing. And if I'm lucky, in these next two videos, the video discussing the casting announcement and the review of the centenary special in September, we'll have a special guest with us. Hopefully, if he agrees. He's someone I've been wanting to have on my channel for a very long, long time, but he's kind of self-conscious when it comes to doing videos, and I've kind of had to like needle him about it and work it to get him to have the confidence. So hopefully by the time that the casting announcement is made, I'll be able to get him on here and we'll have some fun. So, all right. As for Around the World in 80 Days, this is like the 10th Doctor on crack, basically. Phineas Fogg, at least the way David Tennant plays him, it could be the 10th Doctor chameleon arched. Honest to God. Honest to God. His mannerisms are so close to the way that the 10th Doctor is, only more stuffy. and not world weary as much as the Doctor is, because he's not traveled at all. But if you do have the opportunity, please, please, please go check it out. It's has already premiered fully in the US on Masterpiece, in the UK, France, Italy, Germany, everywhere. So please check it out. It's worth it. It is 8 episodes. It is some of his best work. There's a couple speeches that he does in there that I swear could have been a Doctor speech. And I'm not trying to compare this whole thing to the Doctor, because he's not the Doctor in this at all. He's totally different. But the casting choices were on point. The characters, Léonie Binèche, and who plays Abigail Fix, and Passepartout, I mean, the three of them are a great team. And I've also heard it's been confirmed there will be a series 2. I don't know what it's going to be about, because there's only one book around the world. So I don't know what this is, but it's likely going to be another adventure of them going around the world doing something or other. But it is totally worth it. Totally worth an 8-hour day. Trust me, you will enjoy it. David is on point and great as usual. For playing a character who starts out stuffy and a bit of a jerk, he really sucks you in, because he's not stuffy by choice. He's stuffy out of fear. He wants to get out into the world and experience everything the world has to offer, but he's too afraid. And when he's made this offer, this bet, he, right after he gets a postcard from his ex-girlfriend, she's chastising him for being a coward and not having, you know, by showing him this postcard of New York and everything he could have experienced, but he didn't because he let her go and was too afraid to go with her. He decides he's tired of being a coward and he wants to go out there and do it. And the next 8 episodes are basically a mixture of everything falling apart around him, but at the same time, the greatest adventure he's ever had, because it truly helps him understand who he is as a person. It helps him to get over this fear that he's had of being out there in the world through his experiences. He meets people that change his life, specifically Passepartout and Fix. They help him to understand who he is as a person. They help him to understand that being vulnerable is not a bad thing, that you can put yourself out there, and yes, you might get hurt, but you can still pick yourself up and move on, you know. And by the end, you are so like happy for this team that you want them to go on and have adventures forever. And I swear, if they were in the TARDIS, they'd be a great TARDIS team. Awesome. So yes, please do take that for a watch. The 9th Doctor Adventures box set was quite good. This one had a running theme through it, where it was the overarching title of the box set was Lone Warriors, and the three stories within the box set each have to do with a singular villain, a villain who is a lone representative of their race, who is either crash landed on a planet and they're stuck there, or somebody is on the run, or you know, and the Doctor is interacting with each one of these three. Some of the stories are a little slow, but the majority of it is very typical Christopher Eccleston 9th Doctor fare. He always manages to bring the best and worst out of everybody around him, but that's just Chris, how he does as the Doctor. There is not a single story that he can do that is bad. There's always great themes in it, themes of being more than you are, of coming to terms with your past, which is actually a lot of things that he himself as the Doctor would have to come to terms with in time. Again, this is not with Rose. This is before Rose. There's no specific date markers that would tell you, like, when, but fairly certain, at least from the information I've got from Big Finish and from Chris himself, is that these adventures mostly take place before he met Rose. Not during the time that he dropped her off in the alley and then the few seconds before he came back to ask her the second time. It has nothing to do with that. This is before. And I know it might seem, well, if it's before, why is he so lighthearted? Well, he's really good at hiding behind a wall of fake. And yeah, it wasn't until he met Rose and she forced him to confront his past and everything he'd lost that, you know, he couldn't hide behind it anymore. He's always that jolly old madman in a box until you get right down to the heart of it, you know. But again, this is Chris's, this is some great work by Chris, as always. It's always a treat to be able to listen to him as the Doctor. I do know for a fact they're making a third set. It is on sale. I haven't gotten it yet. It's a bit pricey. I will get around to it, though. There's a third set. I'm not sure what the theme of this particular set is, but as soon as I figure it out, I will let you all know. As for David, I know that the docudrama he's making about Litivenko was finished being filmed. It's being shopped around to film festivals right now. They're going to show it there first before they actually show it on the network or on the BBC, but it will be shown. Inside Man is done. I don't know when that's slated to premiere. Good Omens 2 has finished production. We probably won't get a trailer for the season for season 2 till later this year, and it likely won't premiere till early next year. At least according to Neil Gaiman and the millions of times that he's asked every day. right now, David's the focus right now for us as fans is what will happen in the 60th anniversary special. Because there have been tons of rumors about will he or won't he. I mean, it's Russell. He and Russell are still good friends. They're very close. So I cannot imagine a 60th anniversary special that he would not be a part of. I know that there are some fans out there that are a little pissy because Christopher Eccleston has outright said no. They're like, well, that just means the only reason he did Big Finish was for a paycheck. Well, okay. And? Because at the time that he did the Big Finish box sets, when he first started doing it, it was during COVID. And he was... there was no work for actors at the time because everything was in lockdown. Yes, he's an actor, and yes, he's an advocate for the show, but at the same time, he's also a human being. He's a husband and a father of two young children who has to put meat on the table to feed his family. That comes first and foremost. He had always said that he would be, even though his relationship with Russell and the BBC has not thawed, his love for the show is first and foremost. And he would always have respect for the show. He would always respect the fans, and he would always treat it with kindness, no matter what the BBC did to him. Because he knows how important of an institution the show is. And he would never try to hurt it, despite what they put him through. He's always been good to it. So for him to say, well, yeah, I needed a paycheck, that's not what it was all about. Yes, that was part of it. And I can't blame him. I mean, at the time, there was no work. And they weren't sure how long they were going to be out of work. He has two young kids. He has a family to support. So if that means that he's going to do a Doctor Who box set to make some quick cash, I cannot blame him for that. Maybe the way he said it was a little more direct than people are used to, but you're talking about Christopher Eccleston here. He's always been direct. It's an absolute facet of how he plays the Doctor. He's no bullshit, basically. He's blue collar from Salford. Like, he doesn't bullshit around. He's very upfront. He doesn't lie. He doesn't, you know, if you ask him something, he's going to be real, like 100 with you. And even if that's in your face and hurts feelings a bit, it's the truth. It doesn't mean he doesn't have love for the show. He would not have agreed to do it, even if it was a paycheck, if he didn't have love for the show. He's one of those guys that's very particular about the work he chooses, because it has to be good. If it's not good and it's not worth his time, he's not going to do it. So if he didn't think the scripts were good, he wouldn't have done it. And despite everything that the network put him through and that happened behind the scenes, he does have a great love for the character and for the show. And it shows in the box sets and how he does the work. He's incredible. He's just slipped into that role like it was nothing, like he had never left it. And he's amazing. So yes, I would encourage you definitely to go out and get those box sets. It is worth it. Also would encourage you, because I'm so happy about this, Big Finish has done a second box set of Rose Tyler Dimension Canon called Other Worlds. And it's another three stories of her going off to other alternate Earths in her quest to find the Doctor before season four starts. Series four. Billy Piper again is back. Camille Kaduri. So it's going to be awesome sauce. it will not be released till October, though. So please, please go ahead and pick it up. A small update on Absent Friends. That was the Big Finish short story, short trip that was with John Barrowman and David Tennant, having to do with Torchwood. I know they said they would never release it, but because things with John Barrowman have kind of cooled off now, since the whole fracas before, there is a slight possibility that they might eventually get around to it in time. I don't know how long it will take before they feel comfortable doing so, but I think that they will. They have, because they've gotten a lot of complaints on their website from fans that paid for that and that wanted it. And even though they've said, you can get a refund, you can get something else. No, these people wanted that story. I wanted that story. That is a short story or a team up that we've been waiting for a long time. Jack and the 10th Doctor in Torchwood. Because he's never done that before. The Doctor being in Torchwood. So, yeah. This is something we've been waiting for a long time, and we were very disappointed not to get it, especially for something so ridiculous. So, yeah, I think Big Finish has gotten a little tired of getting all the complaints. So they're kind of trying, I think they're trying to find a way to re-release it without causing a fracas. Twitter. Jesus. I think after the Chibnall era is over, they might feel a little more comfortable. Because it seems like that whole woke whatever era of television is starting to decline. A lot of those shows that have come out that have been based around that sort of storytelling are on their way out. Like the Batwoman television show on the CW I just found out is being canceled. Doesn't surprise me because it's terrible. So, you know, I think now that that particular brand of storytelling is on its way out, I think Big Finish might be more inclined at hopefully some close future date to re-release Absent Friends. I will, of course, keep you guys up to date and abreast of that if and when it happens. So now, on to the main part of our story here. Legend of the Sea Devils. I know this review is not going to be long because there's not much to say. This was an episode that wasn't actually ever supposed to happen in the first place. This particular special, the Easter special, was originally meant to be the regeneration episode, but BBC came in at the last minute, the 11th hour as it were, and asked for another one. Another episode at the last minute. So Chibnall had to scrape something together real, real quick. It looks like it could easily have filled a slot in season 13 flux. And it may very well have been filmed for that purpose. You could definitely tell it was filmed with COVID restrictions in mind. There were not a lot of people in the episode. It was very self-contained, either to the village at the beginning or the ship for the majority. It was the Doctor and her two companions, the two Chinese pirates, and one sea devil, pretty much. Oh, and the guy from the village that had the MacGuffin. That was pretty much it. But I know that some fans of this era are trying to use that as an excuse as to why it seemed like it was so choppy. Well, they were all locked down, so they were only able to work with what they had. Look, I don't give a damn. I have seen other shows since that had far less to work with and had done a lot better with it. Despite being on lockdown, despite having restrictions as far as contact and all those things. And they still managed to pump out better episodes than this Drek. So, this episode reintroduces an oldie but goodie villain from classic Doctor Who, the Sea Devils, who made their first appearance in a third Doctor serial called The Sea Devils. They were the original inhabitants of this planet. They're aquatic creatures. And they don't like humans because humans pretty much took over the planet from them without their consent. And they've been basically banished to living underwater because they can't make themselves known to humanity. And they want to take the planet back. That's what they've consistently been trying to do the few times that they've shown up. In this one, these are not the regular sea devils that live underwater, the ones that have a sense of honor and something of a code. These are a group of sea devil pirates that would think nothing of wiping humanity off the face of the earth to take the planet back entirely. With a plan that is as hackneyed as it is illogical. One of the sea devils is turned to stone, and the stone statue is standing in a Chinese village, and it's fallen under the protection of a young man, his family going back hundreds of years. It's their ancestral duty to protect the MacGuffin, the jewel he wears around his neck, because it's the only thing that keeps the statue from coming back to life, and it protects them against the aliens. So the Doctor, Yaz, and Dan just wind up there out of nowhere. I don't know how or why they got diverted. It doesn't make sense them wearing period costumes, even though those costumes weren't very period, if they didn't know they were going to be there in the first place. Dan, of course, looks like complete idiot. He's apparently been dressed by Yaz because apparently he's such a man-child that he can't dress himself, right? This is what we call butt of joke. Once again. You know, Dan could have been something. When he was first introduced in Flux, he could have been something. I really had this feeling that he could have been more than what he was. But, nope. No. They needed someone to replace Bradley, and this is what they got. Someone else to be. Some other white dude to be the butt of the joke. I just feel bad for him. He's a big fan of the show, and to have to come on and play this kind of character when he's obviously capable of much more. Well, that's what happens when you're stuck with a showrunner who doesn't know what he's doing. And we'd prefer to make you the laughing stock instead of actually develop a character around you. So he comes out looking like a moron, and the two of them proceed to make fun of what he's wearing. Because, you know, that's what they do now. Make him the butt of the joke. And he just takes it like he doesn't even realize what's going on. Hey, whatever. The Doctor's earring starts moving her. I don't know what that's about. That's never explained. So she's curious about how and why they got there. They investigate the village. They find out that the sea devil was there. It's escaped. An elderly man has been killed as a result. And the man's son, who is in charge of the MacGuffin, is wanting to find out who killed his father. Or he knows who he believes killed his father. That's another thing about this episode that doesn't make sense. The sea devil, if I remember correctly, was the one that was responsible for the father's death, but he's blaming the female pirate. The female pirate was the one that came to the village. The Madam Ching. She comes to the village to get the MacGuffin because she needs treasure in order to free her sons from captivity. She doesn't realize what she's doing. She releases the sea devil from captivity, and the old man that's trying to stop her dies as a result. So the young man, the son, blames her for what happened, and he's going after her. The doctor, of course, sees her and is like, oh, Wikipedia page, Madame Ching, blah, 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 blah. We can't just develop a character organically anymore. Now, whenever she sees someone famous, she has to give you the Wikipedia download of who they are and why they're important. God help us all. There will never come a time when this doctor has the ability to shut up. Like, ever. I would have preferred to learn more about this character through actual character development as the episode wore on. As a matter of fact, her character and the male pirate from hundreds of years before, I actually found them a slight bit interesting, and I was kind of getting into their story, just the little, what little story there was to get into, and I was hoping that there would be more. I found them very much more interesting than the Doctor and her companions. Again, this is a case of the side characters propping up the main cast, because the main cast have no ability to carry the show whatsoever. But of course, there was not enough development for these two side characters to really go anywhere. So as much as I would like to have gotten into their story and to understand them better and root for them just a little bit more, there was nothing there for me to get behind. Everything happened so quick that there just was very little time. This was actually the shortest special so far, under 50 minutes, and it shows. It's definitely been edited to death. You could tell the pacing is atrocious. There are scenes that don't make sense with other scenes. There are scenes that don't play out. Like, you can definitely tell something was missing. It's fairly obvious there was a lot cut out and left on the cutting room floor that would have probably made the episode make more sense. That would have helped the pacing more. But I don't know, to save time and money or whatever the fuck, they cut out a whole bunch of shit and it just made the episode that much worse. So the Doctor eventually finds out that it's the sea devils that are doing this. The reaction to seeing them, you know, you would have thought there'd be a bigger reaction. This is not the first time she's contended with them. She's dealt with them. She's contended with them before. She knows how much of a threat they can be when they're properly, you know, threatening. This group, I don't know why they decided to become pirates. They just hate humanity, I guess, more than the other sea devils do. And they've decided that they want to reverse the poles. This is their plan. They want to reverse the poles in order to melt the polar ice caps so that the entire planet will become water and the humans will die. You know, I think the Silurians who live underground would have something to say about that, because they also share the planet. And changes in poles is actually something that is scientifically proven to have happened before. It will never happen in a human lifetime, because it only happens every, like, hundreds of thousands of years. But it has happened before. It will likely happen again. And it does not cause polar ice caps to melt. A quick Google search would have probably given them enough information to figure this out. But, hey, you know, you can't really be counted on Chibnall. I know for a fact that the person who co-wrote this episode has never written sci-fi before, and probably only has maybe one other writing credit to their name. The director has only directed short videos, has never actually directed a full feature length anything. And it shows. The fight scenes are choppy. Visually not pleasing. You can't really tell what's going on. Nothing stays still for more than a second. It would have been better to have a wide angle so you could see the Doctor fighting the sea devil all at once, and you would have an idea of what's going on, but you don't. It's just choppy, and it flashes back and forth, and then you just get confused and you're lost, and you don't really have any concept of what is going on other than these two people fighting. The action is very quick. There's very little plot. What we do find out is that the Sea Devils in the 12th century, they kidnapped a famous Chinese pirate. He let his crew go so they wouldn't die. He made the Sea Devils believe that he was working for them when he really wasn't. He was just trying to save his crew and stop them from getting their hands on the MacGuffin. So they've kept him in stasis for like 400 years. And the Doctor and Yaz come upon him. They just ditched Dan at the very beginning of the episode. No fanfare, no nothing. They just ditch his ass with the young man who's going after Madame Ching. Yaz is like, what about Dan? Oh, fuck him. He's fine. Yeah, because, you know, Dan is meaningless. Who cares about Dan? Who cares about their companions? Not the Doctor. Not that she's ever, at least in this incarnation. Oh my god, this version of the Doctor is the coldest, most psychotic version of the Doctor I have ever seen. This woman has so little care for her companions and for the people around her. It is absolutely astounding. So Dan and the young man go after Madame Ching. They get onto her ship and they find out that she's been sailing the ship without a crew. This is when they get the tiny smidgen of her backstory where she tells them that her crew and her children, her two sons, are kidnapped and are being held for ransom by another pirate. And she has to get this treasure in order to pay what the ransom is so she can save her sons. They do kind of turn her into a little bit of a sympathetic character. And I honestly thought that piece of the backstory was interesting. And I would have liked to have seen more. I wanted it to develop more. It never went anywhere after that. Just... So she basically conscripts them onto her crew. And now they have to deal with the Sea Devils. So long story short, the Doctor manages to stop the Sea Devils, because of course she does. They free the ancient Chinese pirate from his captivity, and he helps them by sacrificing his own life to stop them, to stop the Sea Devils. Once again, the Doctor letting someone else die in her stead, because that's what she does now. Not the first time, probably won't be the last. The majority of the action, though, unfortunately, gets stopped or ground to a crushing halt by more Thasman shit. The Doctor takes the TARDIS underwater in order to investigate the Sea Devils / try to show Yaz a good time. I'm not a bad date, am I? Yeah, it's just a throwaway line. Yaz wants it to mean more, but it really doesn't. You can tell by the look in her eyes when she realized that the line really didn't mean anything. It was just the Doctor being quippy. Oh my Lord Jesus. They do eventually come to have this conversation on a beach. See, this is why I felt I needed to review this episode. The plot line is inconsequential. This particular scene, though, I'm sorry, I have to say something. I just... Chibnall? Oh, Chibnall. Wow. Just... Wow.
Right.
What a cock!
Every fan that watched this episode immediately could tell. And it's the truth. I'm not making this up. You could go on Twitter and see the responses to this scene. You could immediately tell that he was ripping off not only Doomsday from season 2, but Journey's End from season 4. This bitch was trying to compare the tragedy and the loss that the Doctor and Rose suffered by being thrust apart and him having to let her go for a second time to a version of himself. Oh, and let's not forget also trying to have the school reunion conversation that Ten and Rose had, referring to Sarah Jane. He was obviously trying to recreate it. You can tell in the dialogue itself. I don't attach myself to anyone because it's too painful in the end, blah, blah, blah. Virtually the same things that the doctor said to Rose. It was basically a rehash of the Curse of the Time Lord speech without it being a rehash of the Curse of the Time Lord speech. This bitch tried to compare Thasmin not only to the Doctor and Rose, but also the Doctor and River. And this is going to be a first for me. This is not something I would ever normally say, because y'all know how I feel about River fucking Song. Don't like her, never have, never will. But even in this instance, I cannot fathom that they could compare a non-relationship like Thasmin to the Doctor and River. I mean, I know that what the Doctor and River had, like, love-wise, is not comparable to what Ten and Rose had. It's totally different. But even that was an established relationship. It was mostly earned, mostly, through years worth of storytelling, an entire season's worth surrounding her character alone, to explain who and what she was and why she was. So there was a relationship there. How deep it was is another matter entirely, but there was a relationship there. Just like there was a relationship with 9, 10, and Rose. It was organic, and it was earned. Those scenes on Bad Wolf Bay, both times, were earned. That loss was earned. The emotion was earned. This, between Thasmin, 13, and Yaz? No. And to have the gall to try to recreate the beach scenes and the school reunion scenes with them is just galling. Just galling. The idea he could think that there's even anything remotely to compare between the two is ridiculous. There is no relationship between 13 and Yaz. There never has been. The stars themselves and Chibnall himself came out and said that the only reason this relationship was put on screen was because one day someone in the production office saw how popular it was on Twitter and said, hey, this is cool, let's do it. To make the fans happy. We haven't developed it before. And he also said, all of them said, there was no plans to ever have this in there in the first place. They just noticed all the fan, you know, craziness over it on Twitter and thought, hey, let's do it. So they just threw that shit in there. No development whatsoever. And you gonna call that a relationship? You gonna try to make it look like, oh, she's so sad because she can't be with her because, you know, you guys, it's human and she's not and she'll live forever. You know, she's gonna curse the Time Lords, blahzy blah. No. Unacceptable. Absolutely unacceptable. Look, I know there are fans out there who don't believe that the Doctor should be with anybody. That it should be just a Doctor and a companion going around and having fun and that's it. There's no room for Hanky Panky and the TARDIS. Whatever you believe. And I've even heard this from people who are adamantly non-shipper when it comes to the Doctor. Even they recognize the relationship that Rose and the Doctor had. The relationship that Rose and that Doctor and River had. Because it was well-developed, well-written, organic, and earned. They might not have agreed with the Doctor having a relationship overall, but they could at least acknowledge that it was well done. And it was earned. It wasn't something that just, you know, just thrown in there. 13 and Yaz, there is literally nothing there. Nothing. And I feel bad for all the fans that have been clamoring to have it done, because they deserve something better than this garbage. It reminds me a whole lot of Swan Queen back in my Once Upon a Time days, when they were crazy over Swan Queen and they hated Hook because Emma was with Hook instead of Regina. So the show, they bashed the show for not having a same-sex couple. So during one of the later seasons of the show, they finally gave the show a same-sex couple in Ruby and Dorothy. Two characters who had barely known each other for 5 minutes and really had no background together. We never saw the relationship develop. Nothing. All of a sudden, they were just automatically true love out of nowhere. And this was supposed to be acceptable, to meet their desire for a same-sex couple. A couple with zero development on screen whatsoever. Just throw it out there just so they can say that it's there and they can shut up. That's basically what BBC is doing with Tasman. They're just throwing it out there so to shut you all up. You guys are so blinded by your Tasman that you're not seeing it. I feel sorry for you. I really do. You deserve better. You really do. Anyway, the centenary is supposed to focus on timeless child stuff. We are having two returning companions. My girl, the mouth on legs, Janet Fielding, will be there. Playing Tegan, my girl Tegan. I love me some Tegan. She will be back. And Miss Dorothy McShane, Ace, will also be returning. We're going to have the Brigadier's daughter will also be there. I don't know how much of it is going to focus on the timeless children. I've read a recent article that confirms via Chibnall himself that he had no plans to resolve the timeless children arc. He basically thought of this storyline because he was adopted. And he wanted to take those feelings and emotions over that part of his life story and transfer it onto the Doctor by showing the Doctor being adopted, I guess. But now has no plans to finish it off. No plans to resolve the storyline. So in the centenary, when she's supposed to regenerate. Oh, and the Master is also returning. Sasha Dewan will definitely be there as the Master. Also, the Lone Cyberman will be there as well. If they have no plans to resolve the Timeless Child storyline, then, like, what is this going to be? Because it looks like the Master has decided to get all the Doctor's enemies together to destroy her. Again, it's a ripoff of other episodes who did it far, far, far better. Because Chibnall is unable to come up with a decent singular idea of his own to save his life. So he has to rip off of other far better episodes and far better writers. The details are sketchy right now with this centenary. I know why. They're trying to keep it close to the vest. It's the regeneration episode, so it's kind of a big deal. I know we should be between now and before September, somewhere in the coming months, we will definitely be getting a casting announcement from the BBC as to who the 14th Doctor is. They've already begun production and somewhat filming of at least the 60th anniversary special. So that's there. Who's going to be in the 60th anniversary special? Still don't know. The only thing that anybody can posit with any certainty at all is David, because I mean, it's Russell, and why wouldn't you want to have the 10th Doctor there? Right? We've also heard rumors that Russell is going to retcon the Thomas Child entirely. I don't know if those rumors are true. I could see him possibly ignoring it and just not speaking of it, like they did with the whole Eighth Doctor is half human thing. But that was easier to ignore. This you can't ignore. This is a total destruction of 60 years worth of canon. You can't ignore that. It's too much. So he's going to have to do something. I have the distinct impression that this rumor might have a grain of truth to it. That he's going to retcon it somehow, or maybe say it was like an alternate universe or alternate reality or something. If he does, that's great. It needs to be gone. I think that's the only thing that will satisfy the fans anymore, is it being gone. It's the wholesale destruction of this show that we love so much. It's just heartbreaking. Just, it hurts. Because the show doesn't deserve it. It deserves so much better. It deserves love and care, and not to be torn apart by politics and agendas. So that's pretty much it for Legends of the Sea Devils. Not much to review. It was a pretty much meh, blah episode. I originally gave it a 5 out of 10 because I was interested in the pirate's background, but since there wasn't much there to develop, it was more like a 3 out of 10. There just wasn't very much there to review, and the whole shit with Thasmin just brought it down to screeching halt. For me, anyway. By the time that beat scene was over, I was not just pissed, I was enraged. Absolutely livid that they would have the gall to do such a thing. It's not about the Doctor having feelings for someone. It's about them trying to recreate Russell's work and David's work and Billy's work and try to compare the two. Like there's some similarity between the relationships. The doctor trying to say that her relationship with Yaz is the most amazing one she's ever had, even in comparison to her own wife. I was like, no. No, I might not like River at all, but that even that doesn't fly with me. No. Absolutely not. So, yeah. And the ratings definitely show. Lowest ratings to date, 2.20. Unbelievable. Even the fans of this era, and you can see it all over Twitter when the ratings came out, could not justify this dumpster fire. Lowest ratings to date in 60 years. Not just lowest rated special. Lowest rated anything having to do with Doctor Who at all. 2.20. That's just sad. This has gotten to the point where fandom just stopped giving a shit anymore. Like, it. Even the Chibnall era fans are like, what is this mess? Even they're starting to question. And the media seems to be following suit by finally admitting to the fact that this era is fucking terrible. I guess it's easy to do that when this era is just about over. You don't have to worry about backlash when there's only one episode left. All right, guys. Well, that is it for me for this review. There's not much else in the way of David Tennant news so far. I know you guys saw my Twitter post online that I did go to Fan Expo Philly and I met him in person. It was the most awesome experience of my life. Bucket list, ching! And I got him to sign my big David Tennant my big doctor statue, he was absolutely, he looked at that thing and was like, oh my God, is that me? Is that really me? Oh, wow. You know, because it, unlike the little ones that, aren't entirely accurate face-wise, this one is very accurate to him. It was taken screen grabbed from the actual episode itself. So they used that in their sculpture, and it was very on point. He was literally going, wow, how did they make it look so much like me? That's amazing. And he autographed it, and I got a picture. I got a photo with him, with me holding it, and it was just, oh my God. I have to tell you, David Tennant is the real deal. He is the sweetest man you'll ever meet in your life. He really is. I mean, even after having been there all day and taking photographs and autographs and answering questions, and there was not a single empty seat in his Q&A panel, and the lines were hella long. I wanted to get up there to ask a question, but I knew it wasn't worth it. There just wasn't enough time. The whole panel itself wasn't more than 45 minutes long, and I knew based on his ability to talk, that it would take time to get through each person's question. But he was so sweet. He talked to everybody. He answered their questions. He was funny. He was nice. He was kind. He was generous with all the people. You know, he made sure everybody got what they paid for. And he was just an all-around sweet guy. Like, just so sweet. So much energy, too. Absolutely so much. Just boundless. Even though he was probably exhausted from having been there all day. Just boundless amounts of energy. Wow. So, that was definitely an experience. A real, true, awesome time. All right, guys. Well, I will try to do another review here. Well, probably not going to be until, yeah, the next time that you guys hear from me, unless David has something else new. I don't know when The Inside Man's going to be premiering, but I have a feeling it might be in the fall. Litivenko, I don't know. It's still right now on the independent film circuit before it goes on, before it premieres on actual BBC TV. So I don't know about that yet either. As I said, Good Omens 2 will not be premiering until at least early next year. And there's really no information about Around the World in 80 Days Series 2. That's not even in post-production yet, because they're still dealing with, he's still Good Omens and stuff. So right now we're kind of, I think he might be focusing a little bit of his time, possibly, hopefully we'll see on Doctor Who, maybe. But as soon as the casting announcements dropped, which I'm certain will be in the next couple of weeks, I will definitely be doing a video, and hopefully it will be a live chat video with my friend who I've been trying to get on for a while now, and we will be discussing about that like crazy, because right now that is the big news that everybody wants to know. Who will be the 14th Doctor? Rumors have flown, David Tennant stuff aside, that it's at least going to be a man. Okay. whether or not this person is a person of color, I don't know. I can't say. I know that BBC has said they want to stick with the diversity, but I just hope it won't be diversity at the expense of character development and acting ability and writing. They have to have seen at this point that the Chibnall era of the show, which employs all those things, is a disaster, and it can't continue to go on, especially now that the BBC's licensing fee that people in the UK are supposed to pay in order to watch TV over there, it's being phased out over the next couple of years. They literally cannot afford to not have watchers, viewers, at this point. So they really need to fix their shit. All right, guys. Well, that's it for me. I will be seeing you when I see you, hopefully in the next couple of weeks. Peace out.
night.